Okay, so let's get started. So what I've done in the last couple of lectures is to discuss aspects of structure formation, right? So the first lecture was just an overview. The second lecture covered basic aspects of the statistics that one needs to study structure formation. Yesterday I also spoke about the spherical evolution model, which is one of the simplest models which helps us build an intuitive understanding of what is happening when structure evolves in the universe. So today what we'll do is put together these ideas and describe a model, a formalism called the excursion set approach, which is I think currently the only formalism which allows you to make reasonably accurate predictions for the fully nonlinear regime of structure formation as far as the abundances and clustering of collapsed objects is concerned. Okay, so we'll discuss the foundational principles of this formalism and we'll see some applications. So I'll start with a brief recap of what we've already discussed. So we know that we would like to understand the evolution of structure starting from initial conditions, which are a realization of an almost Gaussian random field. And then from simulations, we know that structure evolves. Overdense regions tend to become more densely clustered. Underdense regions tend to become emptier. And eventually, at late times, you have this complicated and very intricate cosmic web of structure that one sees. And this is in simulations, but we also know from observations of galaxy surveys, for example, that this is basically the correct picture of the universe. So the galaxy surveys show us pictures which are qualitatively very similar to the kind of things that we end up seeing in simulations. So we'd like to build an analytical understanding of what is happening here. And the basic problem that we are trying to address is the gravitational evolution of a cold and collisionless system of dark matter. And there are observational reasons why one wants to deal with this. We can discuss this at some point. What is the observational evidence that tells us that there must be dark matter in the universe and that it must be cold and collisionless to a good approximation? So the initial conditions, like I said, are a realization of almost Gaussian process. We also know, and you have been studying in these lectures, that at large scales and or at early times, the perturbations in this in the density field of the universe are small. So you can linearize the equations that you would like to study, and then you end up studying linear perturbation theory. And in what you have been studying is, to be specific, relativistic perturbation theory at linear order. What we are interested in here is the evolution and structure of the universe at relatively small scales. Now, at small scales, the perturbative approach does not work. But a nice thing that happens is that at small scales, the full complications of general relativity also do not play a role. You are left with the Newtonian limit of GR. So even though it is a nonlinear system, at least it is Newtonian. Okay, so relativistic effects do not play any role almost at these small scales. So what we want to study is fully nonlinear but Newtonian gravity. And the main issues that we want to address at small scales is basically how to go from this stochastic realization of a Gaussian random field and evolve it at small scales using Newtonian gravity. So this is the challenge. And all of this can be summarized very succinctly by simply asking these two questions. When and where does gravitational collapse occur? By gravitational collapse, I mean the formation of a gravitationally self-bound object, which is a collection of dark matter particles. Okay, so if I could look at the initial conditions in the realization of the Gaussian random field that I am given, if I could look there and I could go around and saying, aha, here is an interesting region. This region will, after a time t, become a collapsed object of mass m. Then I go somewhere else and I find another region. And I say, okay, this one is also interesting. It will, after a time t2, become a collapsed object of mass m2. Okay, and so on and so forth. If I were able to do this exercise, looking only in the initial conditions and going around identifying interesting locations and assess and, you know, and prescribing a time and a mass scale for the collapsed object that is going to form, this would be very useful for me, because then looking at the initial conditions, I could predict at any given later time, what is the spectrum of collapsed objects that I am left with? What are the masses of these collapsed objects? Where are they located? And so on. And if you think about it, this is exactly what you would like to know if you want to predict this kind of picture from this kind of picture without having to run an n-body simulation. Right? So that's the kind of goal here. Feel free to interrupt and ask questions if anything is not clear. Okay. So just to remind you, these are the kind of equations that we are talking about. These probably you have not seen in these lectures, but there's nothing very difficult about them. They're just the fluid equations that you are familiar with from fluid dynamics, except that we are talking about collision-less systems. They are self-gravitating systems. So instead of an Euler equation with pressure terms, you only have a gravitational acceleration. And self-gravity means that the Newtonian potential is determined by the Poisson equation. So what you would like to understand is the evolution of the density contrast and the peculiar velocity flow. And these are not the equations Dimitri has been using, because those were linearized versions, okay, of the relativistic theory. This is non-linear and non-relativistic. Okay. We can also discuss later how one would derive these self-consistently in such a way that in the appropriate limit you recover what Dimitri has been talking about. That is also entirely possible. All right. This is something we already saw. So a particularly simple application of those equations is to say, let's consider spherically symmetric density perturbations, in which case those equations simplify considerably, and we saw that the solutions can be, you can parameterize the solution in terms of the radius of a collapsing ball, and that radius, its time evolution, is given by these equations. The density of mass enclosed in that radius is simply given by this expression, and we also pointed out that instead of using time or theta as a clock, I could also just ask, what does the linear theory value of the density contrast do as a function of time? So I could use that as a clock, okay, and that looks like this. And what we said is that collapse in this simple model occurs at a value theta equals 2 pi, where formally this density becomes infinite, but instead you can replace it with the viral condition and then say that instead of having an infinity here, you will replace it with the density at viralization. So that's the nonlinear density. And at theta equals 2 pi, the linear value of the density contrast takes this value. Okay, so I just plug in theta equals 2 pi here and I get 1.686. So this 1.686 is going to play a crucial role in today's lecture. So let's think about what this is telling us. So what this is saying is that give me an initial Gaussian random field. A perturbation which came from a Gaussian random field, and I'm focusing on a spherically symmetric perturbation which is evolving nonlinearly like this. I am asking what linear theory does in this language. And for this particular model, I know that theta equals 2 pi is an interesting time. Right? Because at this time, as we argued yesterday, viralization is expected to happen. So now, what one is saying here is that if I just take linear theory and I start at the initial time and I evolve simultaneously along with the nonlinear model, right? So the nonlinear model is doing its own thing. It is expanding initially, turning around, going down, viralizing, and stabilizing at theta equals 2 pi. Alongside, I'm evolving the linear model, and I'm asking at theta equals 2 pi, what is the linear model doing? And the linear model is becoming 1.686. So what does that mean? It means that if I take a patch in the initial conditions such that the value of delta linear extrapolated to the time of interest is 1.686. Okay, so consider such a patch. I take a patch, a sphere, and the initial density of this sphere is chosen very carefully in such a way that at present time, for example, the linear theory value of that initial density becomes 1.686. That patch, according to the nonlinear model, would become a viralized object. Is this argument clear? If it's not clear, raise your hands. Yes, okay. So what I'm saying is, let's consider a patch in the initial conditions. So I take a patch. So I have initial conditions which are kind of smooth, almost smooth, small perturbations. So I take a patch here, a sphere of radius r, and I calculate the density contrast smooth on this sphere at this location. I can always do this using the techniques that we've been discussing. And its value turns out to be delta initial. So now what I'm saying is, suppose this delta initial were such, so this is at some scale factor A initial. Suppose this delta initial is such that under linear evolution, at A equals 1, the value of this delta becomes equal to, so this is delta today. In linear theory, suppose this becomes 1.686. Okay, consider such a patch. According to the spherical model, the fully nonlinear solution of gravitational evolution would lead to a virialized object at the location of this patch at A equals 1. Right? That's what the spherical model is telling us. Whatever the nonlinear model is doing, I know what the linear model is doing alongside. So now I'm going from the point of view of the linear model and asking, give me an initial patch which satisfies this condition, that under linear theory, which I know how to solve perfectly. So under linear theory, it became 1.686 today. Now I have a nonlinear model which tells me that actually, because the evolution is not linear, it's nonlinear, and that nonlinear evolution will lead to a collapsed object today. So that's really interesting, because it gives me a way of looking in the initial conditions, right? Give me a realization of a Gaussian random field, sit at a point, put a sphere of radius r around you, and calculate the value, just measure the value of the density contrast smooth in that sphere. Use linear theory to extrapolate that value to the time of interest, today, let's say. And I know how to do linear extrapolation because I understand the growth factor in linear theory. So if I do this extrapolation and I find a value that is equal to 1.686, then it tells me that according to the spherical model, that initial patch would actually nonlinearly evolve and become a collapsed object today. Okay? So this is a very, very powerful argument. Good. So question is that patch 200 times denser than the background? In the initial conditions, definitely not, because the initial conditions are small perturbations. Exactly. So what is being predicted by the spherical model is that if I had followed the nonlinear evolution of that patch, then today it should be a patch which is 200 times approximately denser than the background. Exactly. That's the prediction of this model. Yeah. Good. Okay, so this also we know from before. So I have a dynamical model now. So what I was trying to argue here is that we would like to ask these two questions, right? When and where does collapse occur? So the when is answered by the spherical evolution model. It says that you take any initial lower density. This is another way of thinking of it. Take any initial lower density and keep linearly extrapolating it until the time where its value becomes 1.686. Right, so just focus on the linear model again and just ask, take any delta initial and just keep using linear theory forwards in time and keep asking, am I equal to 1.686 or not? Find the time at which I become 1.686. That is the time at which this particular patch will collapse. Okay, so that's another way of thinking of it. So the when of the problem is solved by the spherical collapse model, at least within this approximation. For the where of the problem, you have to realize that now you're talking about a Gaussian random field, right? So we have a Gaussian random field specified by its power spectrum. We've seen all this notation before. This is just a simple recap. It's statistically homogeneous and isotropic. This is what the power spectrum looks like for typical models that we are interested in, okay? And what we will now argue is how to use this information about the when coming from the dynamics, and combine it with the statistics of the initial field to answer the question of where collapse will happen. Okay, and this is exactly what I was trying to argue here. So let's do that in a little more detail. But so this idea is behind what is called the excursion set approach. So the excursion set approach, the main insight that it uses is that I can separate the dynamics from the statistics. So the statistics is given to me by the initial conditions as a realization of a Gaussian random field. And for the dynamics, what I will do is think of isolated clumps of objects, and I will apply simple toy models like the spherical collapse picture to these isolated clumps. Now, in principle, you know, you might wonder, why is this at all possible? Because I have a realization of some Gaussian process. It has these long wavelength correlations, you know, fluctuate. There are Fourier modes all over the place. There is a power spectrum. And then I am evolving everything under these equations of gravity, right? These are the actual equations that I have to solve. So why am I allowed to think of isolated clumps and toy models where nothing else is happening? I just take a spherical patch here and I evolve it as if there's nothing else in the universe, right? So the spherical collapse model, the way we set it up, was saying, consider a single spherical perturbation in an otherwise completely homogeneous universe. So there are no other patches nearby to perturb you and so on, right? And then the spherical collapse picture gives you some nice results. So why am I allowed to use this in a realistic setting where I have all kinds of perturbations everywhere? So the answer to that question is discussed here. So let's build up the argument. Yeah. So there is some notation here that is introduced. So this is the notion of a Lagrangian displacement field. So what I would like to say is that take any initial fluid element of dark matter and under gravitational evolution, follow its location as a function of time. So if my fluid element had an initial position q, then at a later time, under gravitational evolution, I can always say that its position x at time t is the initial position q plus some displacement field. Okay? And this displacement field, this displacement vector, will depend in general on, of course, on the time that which you're looking at. And it will also in general depend on which fluid element I'm looking at. Okay, so this psi will be a function of the q that you're talking about and a function of time. And if you think about it, you know, this is one way of formulating the problem such that if I were able to give you a good model for this vector psi as a function of q, then I have actually solved the entire problem of structure formation, right? Because you give me any fluid element in the initial conditions, someone came and gave me an excellent model for psi, then I know exactly where every fluid element will reach in the final conditions at time t. And that is the answer that you're looking for. Okay, so one way of thinking about structure formation is that it is the quest to find an accurate model for psi. And this psi is called the Lagrangian displacement field. Lagrangian because this q is a Lagrangian coordinate. It is a label that you assign to a fluid element. Right? That's how you think of Lagrangian dynamics. As opposed to x, which is an Eulerian coordinate. It is the value of, you know, it is the place where you're sitting. You're asking for a fluid element to reach you. Okay. All right. So one of the earliest and simplest models for psi came from Zeldovich in 1970. This is called the Zeldovich approximation. I hope I will have time to discuss it in a later lecture. But for the time being, let's just take the answer from the Zeldovich approximation. And basically what this says is that this psi is approximated by its linear perturbation theory value, which one can prove is proportional to the velocity perturbation, the linear velocity perturbation. Okay. So this is the way the Zeldovich approximation works. There are some factors here which one can discuss later. These are very, very interesting factors from the point of view of large-scale structure, but this is not the point here, so let me not discuss them. Okay, so this is my model for psi. I can Fourier transform it, and I get, you know, I get this expression because what I did is I just Fourier transformed the linear velocity. And if you go back to the continuity equation, you will see that in the linear regime, the velocity perturbation is related in a very simple way to the density contrast. So I can, in Fourier space, just write this down. Okay, so my density contrast Fourier mode appearing here with some powers of k. Why am I doing this? Because now what I can ask for is the typical RMS displacement of a randomly chosen fluid element of dark matter over the age of the universe. Okay? That would be given by this quantity. So I take psi dot psi expectation value. And it's very easy now to do this calculation because I just gave you a model for psi, right? So plug in that model for psi and just, you know, take all the dot products that you need to. And now you will end up with expectation values of delta k prime, etc. Right? So now you can go back to your definition of the power spectrum, put those expectation values, replace them in terms of power spectrum and Dirac deltas, do the appropriate integrals. Right, and what you will get is this expression. So this is a nice exercise to try. If you are able to show that this expectation value is equal to this integral, then it shows that you have understood how Fourier transforms and definition of power spectrum and expectation values works in this context. So it's a very, very useful exercise to do. It should take only 2 minutes to do, and it will help you understand a lot of the factors, etc. Okay, so make sure that the 6 pi squared is correct and so on. But the point is that this RMS displacement now I have written as an integral over the linear theory power spectrum. In the linear theory power spectrum, we understand there are fitting functions available, or you take toy models or something like this. And what you can do is calculate this integral. You can numerically evaluate this integral. And the answer, I am telling you, you can go back and check using a simple fitting function for the power spectrum. It turns out to be about 10 megaparsec squared. So this is a squared displacement. So I have MPC squared, and it's 10 H inverse MPC squared, roughly. Compare this number to the Hubble size at current time, which is 3 gigaparsec. Okay. So what is this saying? It's saying that a typical dark matter fluid element is only going to move about 100th or 1/30th or something of the total Hubble length in one Hubble time. So a typical dark matter particle is not going to move much. Which is another way of saying that anything nonlinear that is going to happen to dark matter. So if this dark matter fluid element from the initial conditions, if it is going to end up in a halo of mass m or something, then the overall displacement that it has experienced is not going to be a large amount. So if you remember one of the plots that I was showing you yesterday from simulations, where what was being done was to trace back the particles in a simulation backwards in time and see where they came from. This is another way of seeing the same thing, right? That halos are going to form more or less in the same region. In regions of order 10 MPC. They're not going to have particles that moved all over the edge of the universe, you know, from the edge of the universe to us today. And the reason simply is that the velocities that you're talking about are non-relativistic. So they don't allow typical particles to move over large distances. So this is why it is useful to think about the toy models in which I don't worry about very long wavelength correlations to begin with. So the small scale dynamics is in fact very, very local. Okay, it's 10 MPC over a universe of size 3 gigaparsec. So that's why there is some hope that I can use a model like spherical collapse and apply it to the initial conditions, even though the initial conditions have long wavelength correlations, right? But I can still think of the spherical collapse model as a useful way of solving for the dynamics. So this is the main reason why something like the excursion set approach is expected to be useful. All right, so this is just setting up some notation now. All the action in the excursion set approach takes place in this plane of overdensity versus what is called sigma zero here. I was calling it sigma in the previous lecture. And this sigma zero squared or sigma squared is just the variance of the density contrast smoothed on some scale r. Okay. So if I fix the scale r and I give you a power spectrum, then you will get a single value for this sigma squared or s. But what I would like to do now is to allow for changes in r. I would like to understand the initial conditions as a function of smoothing scale. So instead of using the smoothing scale R itself as the variable, it turns out, for reasons that we will see, that it's much nicer to use sigma zero as the variable. And in any case, there is a one-to-one relation between R and sigma zero, because if I fix the power spectrum here and I pick a form for the filter, let's say I pick a top hat spherical filter or a Gaussian filter, then there is an analytical one-to-one relation between the value of R and the value of S. Can someone remind me whether this is a monotonically increasing or decreasing relation? So if I increase the value of R, will S increase or decrease? Louder? I can hear both increase and decrease. So how many people think that S will increase if I increase the value of R? Nobody thinks that. How many people think that S will decrease if I increase the value of R? Okay, several people think that. So some of the people who think this, can you quickly explain to me why S should decrease as I increase R? Is there a simple reason, one line explanation that will convince me? Okay. What about as R goes to infinity, what should happen? Louder, louder. S should go to zero. So what is the physical picture that this is describing? If S goes to zero as R goes to infinity, what is it saying? Louder, louder. Yes, good. The universe is homogeneous on the largest scales. S is the variance of a stochastic process. The mean value of this distribution has been defined to be zero, right? So when S is going to zero, what this is saying is that the probability distribution of delta is a Dirac delta centered at zero. In other words, as R goes to infinity, I'm describing a homogeneous universe which has no density fluctuations, right? So that makes sense. And this is also something that we were discussing yesterday in terms of hierarchical structure formation, because I want this variance to be small when I have larger mass enclosed, so that in terms of time as well, things work out correctly. Good. So S is a monotonically decreasing function of R, which means that if I plot S or sigma zero on this axis, this side has large scales and this side has small scales. Okay. And sigma zero equal to zero is basically infinitely large scales. I can also discuss things instead of length scales. I can say that every length scale, every sphere of size R in the initial conditions, it encloses a mass which is approximately proportional to R cubed. Because the mass would be 4/3 pi R cubed times the density enclosed in that sphere. But I'm talking about the initial conditions. So the density enclosed in that sphere is very close to being mean density, because density fluctuations are very small in the initial conditions. Okay, so every radius R is related to a mass m, which is basically R cubed up to some constant. So that means that this side is not only large length scales, it is also large masses, and this side is small masses. On the vertical axis, I have plotted delta smooth on the scale R corresponding to this value sigma zero. Okay, so given a value of sigma zero, I can use this relation to invert and get the scale R, and I will ask what is the value of delta smoothed on that scale R in different situations. So that is on this axis, and of course delta is defined in such a way that positive values are overdense and negative values are underdense. The other way of thinking about this axis is that these positive values or large values are referring to early times, and lower values are referring to late times. We will see why this is the case as we go along. Okay. All right. So now the game is the following. I take my initial conditions. I sit at a randomly chosen point, which I have for generality, you know, without loss of generality, I've placed it at the center of this patch. Let me put down a sphere of some size, some big size R, and calculate the value of the density contrast smooth over this radius R centered at this location. I will get some value delta. Now change the size of the smoothing radius, sit at the same place, and recalculate the density contrast inside the new radius. Will I get the same value? Can I predict what value I will get? Given this value, is there a specific value that I will get for the lower scale? Or is there, you know, or I don't know what I will get. I could get something, I could get something else. You are saying it should increase. Why should it increase? Okay. Anyone else? It should be random. So that's another answer. And in fact, that is the correct answer because I have given you a realization of a Gaussian random field. So I have not told you exactly what the mass distribution is here. So now, depending on what the mass distribution is here, I could increase or I could decrease. Both things could happen. Yeah. So try to convince yourself that in fact, both things could happen. There is no inconsistency if the value of delta increases or delta decreases once I decrease the radius r. Okay. Because this is a random realization. So depending on exactly what kind of distribution I have here in this ring, my value of delta could either increase or decrease. Okay. And then for a different realization, something else might happen. And now what I will do is I will keep decreasing the radius r, and every time I decrease the radius r, I will calculate delta and I will record the value of delta. I'll keep doing this, all the way to small scales. And now what I will get maybe is something that looks like this. Okay, so I will get a trajectory in the plane of delta versus this sigma zero, which will keep stochastically moving up and down depending on the realization that I happen to pick. If I pick a different realization, I'll get a different trajectory. The only thing I can say for certainty is that if r were absolutely infinite, so if this were like really, really large, then almost certainly by the value of delta I would get would be zero, because the variance of fluctuations is vanishing there. So I will always, you know, there's no stochasticity left. I will always keep getting zero. But that's the only thing I can say for sure. Otherwise, I will keep getting some values of delta depending on which realization I happen to pick. So now things become interesting because what I am calculating, okay, so one last piece of technical information is that what I am doing here is, although I am calculating this in the initial conditions, I will always evaluate these quantities by multiplying with the growth factor, linear theory growth factor, so that I'm talking about linear extrapolated values at present time. Okay, so instead of delta initial, this is what I am calculating here with smoothing radius r. Instead of this, I will multiply with the growth function d at z equals 0 divided by d at z equals initial times delta initial, and I will define this to be delta r. This is the linearly extrapolated value of this initial condition. I'm always allowed to do this. There's nothing stopping me from doing this because this is just some function of time. Okay, it's a constant that I'm multiplying. And it's just to make life simple. And what I am plotting in this plot, always in that plot, is this quantity, the linearly extrapolated value to present time. Okay? All right. So now things are interesting because spherical collapse told us that if I have a patch whose linearly extrapolated value is 1.686, then that patch will form a collapsed object of the mass scale over which you smooth. That was the argument from spherical collapse. So now what I have done is I have constructed for you a trajectory as a function of smoothing radius, large radii here, small radii here. And this trajectory is doing something. But on the same plot, I can plot 1.686, the constant line. So spherical collapse is now telling us that all of these smoothing scales, all of these smoothing scales and these smoothing scales, they satisfy the condition that they that at those smoothing scales, that patch is overdense enough that it can form a collapsed object by today. Okay, and the collapsed object of this mass could form, of this mass could form, and so on. That is the spherical collapse argument. And this idea was used first by Press and Schechter in 1974. So this is what why I have labeled the slide as thresholded regions. So what they argued is that everything above this line is a candidate for being a halo of mass M. So this is the original way in which the excursion set idea was used. This idea was improved in the late 80s and early 90s. And people pointed out that actually there is an inconsistency in this way of thinking. You cannot simply say that all of these objects are going to be, should be counted as collapsed objects. Because what I am doing is sitting at one point and putting down spheres of different radii. So suppose that in this particular example, this is some large radius, this is some small radius. Okay, so if I go back here, so there is that largest radius, and let's say this is some small radius, and here I am above 1.686, here also I am above 1.686, but clearly this radius, as the universe evolves, if this outer radius is going to become a collapsed object, it will squeeze the inner radius, and you know that this part of the mass will not show up as a new object. It is already contained in the outermost radius, which is already above 1.686. So I should only worry about the largest radius at which I have hit 1.686. Okay, so in this language, I have to worry about the first scale at which I cross for 1.686. So this is a first crossing problem. Okay, and this is what was done in these later papers. It's interesting that Alan Heavens was here last week. John Peacock is sitting right there, so you should catch him at least. Alan has left. So you should catch John over coffee and lunch to discuss this further. All right. And now nice things can be done with this idea, because you could now try to ask, how do I analytically estimate the distribution? So this is for one realization of the initial conditions. Suppose I change my initial conditions. I set my random number seed to be something else. I generate a new set of initial conditions. Repeat the exercise. I will get some other trajectory. And that other trajectory will cross 1.686 for the first time at some other smoothing scale. Maybe I have a trajectory that does this, and then it crosses here. Okay. So every time I change the initial conditions, I will record a different value for the scale of first crossing of this barrier. I can think of this 1.686 as a barrier for my trajectory. Every time the trajectory hits the barrier, I say that at that scale, a halo of mass m will form. So different realizations give you different trajectories, and each trajectory gives you a different first crossing scale. So if I have an ensemble of realizations, then I get a distribution of first crossing scales. Okay, and the goal is to try to calculate this distribution. So this distribution is denoted here by this quantity f of nu. Nu is simply this particular variable. So what I have done is sigma 0 is the same variable that I used from before. This delta c now has the 1.686 and a 1 plus z. And what has happened here is that I am allowing the time of interest to be different from present epoch. Present epoch would be redshift 0. But suppose I'm interested in collapse not at redshift 0, but at redshift 2. Physically, what I expect is that if a halo of the same mass has to form today versus at redshift 2, then the initial overdensity from which it came should be different. Because if it has to form today, it has to have an initial overdensity, which is something. If the same mass object had to form at redshift 2, its initial overdensity should have been higher. Okay, and that is what is being accounted for by this factor. And there's a much more rigorous way also of seeing this. This is a very heuristic way of seeing this, that things that need to form at earlier time with the same mass have to be more overdense initially. The more rigorous way of seeing this is to simply realize that always what I'm plotting on this axis is the value of delta linearly extrapolated to present epoch. Okay, so the spherical model says that at the time of collapse, the linear extrapolated value is 1.686. So my initial density went from its initial value to 1.686 at the time of collapse. And if I keep linearly extrapolating from the time of collapse to today, I will pick up an extra growth factor in it. Okay, so I will pick up an extra value of 1 plus z coming from there. So I won't spend too much time on this. Just remember the heuristic picture that things that collapsed earlier needed to be more overdense. That is what is coming here. And this nu is this variable, which is delta c over sigma. It is basically asking how significant is my fluctuation delta c with respect to the stochasticity given by the RMS displacement sigma zero. So when I form an object of mass m, am I a 1 sigma fluctuation? Am I a 2 sigma fluctuation? So that is the value of nu that is being seen here. Okay, and already this language should make you realize that things which have large mass will be rarer, because large mass means small sigma zero, right? That means large nu. So in terms of a Gaussian nu, this is going to be a large sigma fluctuation, as opposed to small mass objects for which sigma zero is large. So nu is small and I can have very frequent fluctuations which satisfy this condition. So the excursions at Ansatz says that I can relate the distribution of these first crossing scales to the number density of objects of mass m. And this is the Ansatz, this is the way one writes it. And this is very nice because you come up with your favorite way of calculating this f of nu, and then you can simply plug everything in. This is just a Jacobian to take you from nu to mass, and everything is known because sigma zero is a known function of mass. There is a specific integral that you have to do. You can differentiate it. Everything is completely analytical, right? So this is a very nice way of predicting the number density of collapsed objects. Okay, so this is the way one works. This is the old answer from Bond et al. 1991, which is factor 2 times the press sector answer. We can discuss why this comes about. And this works reasonably well, but not really extremely well, because we are living in an era of precision cosmology. So you would like to do better than this. So what is shown here is the result of simulations with the data points, and the simulations have been recast in this language. Okay, so what was measured in the simulation is this quantity, d and d log m, number density of halos per unit logarithmic mass interval. And using this formula, you got an estimate for nu f nu from the simulations, which has been plotted as the points. The red line, solid line, is a fitting function, which was introduced by Ravi and Beppe Thormann. It has this particular shape. And the fitting function is a fitting function. It works quite well. It was adjusted. Parameters were adjusted to make it work. What is interesting is to see this dotted line, which is called PS, press sector. But what is actually being plotted is this function. Okay. So this function, the blue dotted line, it has the same qualitative shape as the measurements, but you can see that it's not quantitatively correct. It significantly underestimates the number of halos at large masses. This nu, remember, is monotonically increasing with mass. So this is a large mass end, low mass end. So prescector or excursion sets has too many objects at low masses, too few objects at large masses. It's a traditional answer. Okay. So now there is a technical issue here, which is that this particular answer made a specific choice for the nature of the stochasticity of this trajectory. In particular, what it decided to do is to say that let's assume that there are no correlations between the heights of the walks as I change the smoothing radius. So rather, let me say that more precisely. When I change the smoothing radius from one value to the next, it's like taking a step in the trajectory, right? So the trajectory has gone from here and it has jumped down here. So it has taken a step downwards. So what this analytical formalism of Bond et al. Assumed is that this step that it has taken is uncorrelated with whatever has happened before. And you may be familiar with this idea from the study of Brownian motion. Okay, so this is called a Markovian process, where I have a random walk, where each step in the walk is uncorrelated with whatever has happened before. And in this particular limit, of this limiting assumption allowed them to derive this analytical function. But actually what will happen is that we are talking about a system like this, a situation like this, where I am putting down spheres in real space, and I am smoothing the same density fluctuations, right? So now what will happen is that as I change my smoothing radius, every time I am always including the fluctuations that are at the very center. So clearly, the fluctuations that I am including in the big sphere cannot be completely independent of the fluctuations that I include in the smallest sphere. Because part of those fluctuations are the same. So there must be correlations. Okay? And these correlations must be accounted for. And in general, this is a very hard problem because it's an infinite dimensional problem. Imagine taking the continuum limit of this stepping picture. Right, so I have an infinite number of steps to account for, and each step is correlated with every other step. So it's a very difficult problem in general if I didn't know anything else. It turns out that there is a simplification, that these steps turn out to be strongly correlated for smoothing filters like the top hat filter. So what is shown here is an actual random trajectory generated on a computer, assuming uncorrelated steps, which is the black line, and you can see that there is a very jagged nature. And what I did was to smooth the same trajectory using a top hat smoothing filter, and I get the red line. So the red line is also a stochastic trajectory. It is going down and it's going up in some way, but it's doing this very smoothly. Okay, so this is a very nice simplification that happens. I won't go into too many details of this. You can look at the slides later. But it turns out that this simplification really dramatically allows you to, you know, it's a dramatic simplification. It takes you from an infinite dimensional problem to a two-dimensional problem, effectively. What you can show is that all you care about now, so if I put a barrier, if I draw a line 1.686 somewhere, and I want to know what is the probability that this kind of trajectory will cross this barrier for the first time at a particular scale, all I need to demand is that the trajectory should be at the barrier, at the scale of interest, and it should be going from below to above. Because if I demand these two conditions, then you can see from the nature of this trajectory that if, as long as I am going from below to above, I have already accounted for the fact that I am doing this for the first time. Because going from below to above means that on scales which are larger, I had to be below. The nature of the correlations forces me to be below. So almost certainly I was below on a range of scales which are larger than the scale of interest. So as long as I am accounting for being at the barrier and going from below to above, I should be fine. Okay, so first crossing can be replaced with up crossing. And now things become very simple. It's a two-dimensional integral to be done. You can just do it. And the answer turns out to be something like this. It's more complicated than the Preschecker answer, but not much more. There's an error function involved. Okay, and nothing much more is happening. So this is very nice. It also works extremely well. So this is a comparison of this particular model with different power spectra. So Monte Carlo walks generated with different power spectra and with different barrier shapes. You don't have to assume a constant barrier. You can keep changing the shape of the barrier. And the formalism works quite well. All right. So this is as far as this technical issue of correlated steps versus uncorrelated steps was concerned. There are more physical issues that one has to account for. So what I showed you is that here, the Preschecker answer doesn't work really well. And it turned out that if I just apply this technical improvement of correlated steps, that will simply pull down this by a factor 2. So it will improve things at low masses, but at high masses, I still have a problem. So there is still something missing, and there is some physics missing, as I will argue next. So one idea that one has to realize is that we have been saying all along that I can choose my location for the center of my spheres arbitrarily. So pick an arbitrary place in the initial conditions and put down spheres. Find the sphere which has delta C, you know, delta initial hitting bigger than delta C. That radius you call as the mass of the halo. Then arbitrarily go somewhere else, repeat the exercise. But this is almost certainly not the way the universe works. Because you would expect just on heuristic grounds that collapse will not happen anywhere. Collapse is a result of gravitational evolution, so I should be in a situation where I'm allowed to pull matter together. And a place where I can pull matter together could be a peak in the initial density field. Because at a peak, my matter contrast is, you know, it is some value and then it's falling off in all directions. That's what a peak means. So this is a candidate for an actual location where collapse might be easier to occur. And in fact, this has been tested in simulations as well. I'll show you something in the next slide. So that is one effect that one needs to account for. I should not sit at random locations. I should probably be sitting at special locations in the initial conditions, then applying excursion sets. Yeah? An RMS displacement of 10 MPC, yes? Yes. So, no. So we are not accounting for displacements in this model. We are sitting at one location and doing everything, right? I'm just sitting here and doing this. And all of this displacement is supposed to be captured by the dynamics of the problem. And the dynamics, we have said, we will believe whatever spherical collapse tells us. So we have taken that information effectively into account by declaring that the spherical collapse model is accurate. Okay? So the spherical collapse will make the particles move eventually. We are not making them move. We are just saying, give me the initial positions of these particles. Spherical collapse will do something. All we care about is what is the mass of the halo that will come out at the end. We can discuss this later if you like. What I want to argue next is that, so one idea is that one should not be sitting at arbitrary locations. You may want to sit at special locations. The other is that spherical collapse itself may not be a good approximation to dynamics, because not just the initial density, but the initial tidal field may also play a role in determining collapse. So I was mentioning yesterday that you may want to think about ellipsoidal dynamics rather than spherical dynamics. And this also will play a role. So how these two things can be accounted for is another question. It turns out that this can be done. So this is an example showing you that collapse in fact occurs near density peaks. So what is shown here is particles in a simulation which were traced back to the initial conditions. So these pretty pictures were made by my collaborator, Oliver Hahn. And what he has shown is in this gray ellipsoidal looking patch are the actual particle positions moved back to the initial conditions. And you can see that they have a nice ellipsoidal structure, etc. Okay. Then what is shown in the color is density contours with values of delta equal to these values. Okay, isodensity contours. And you can see that, so these are particles which eventually formed a halo. And you can see that they came from something that looks more or less like an initial density peak. It has a complicated structure at very small scales, but more or less there is a peak-like structure. There are more complicated things that can happen. Most of the simulation halos will end up looking like this, about 70 to 80% of them. And the remaining 10 or 20% of them, 20 or 30% of them will end up looking like this. These are almost certainly things that have recent mergers. So you see the effect of the protohalos of two big halos that collided recently. Okay. All right. And this was shown for CDM by Aaron Ludlow and Cristiano Porciani in 2011. Yeah. No, there's no evolution. These are three different patches, three different protohalo patches. So what I was saying was that you should try to account for the fact that collapse occurs at peaks. And in fact, you can do this. The formalism for this also existed in the literature. We were able to put things together. And what you now find is that spherical collapse at the locations of peaks, in fact, gives you a completely the wrong answer. Instead of predicting too few halos, now it predicts too many halos. Okay, so this dotted curve is a fitting function from simulations. This red curve is the result of saying that assume spherical collapse occurring at peaks. And now, clearly, this is also not enough. So if you want to build a model which gets you within 10% of what is seen in simulations, you have to actually put in all of these ingredients. You have to take the excursion set picture, you have to sit at peaks, and you have to account for the fact that the tidal effects in the initial conditions also play a role. So let me not go into technicalities of this. Yeah. So all you have to say is that I have a Gaussian random field. A peak means that the first derivative of density is zero, and the second derivative of density is negative. So in 1D, this would be simply d delta by dx equal to zero, d2 delta by dx squared is less than zero. All three, delta, d delta by dx, and d2 delta by dx squared are Gaussian random variables, right? Because think of how I construct a derivative. Derivative is delta at x minus delta at x plus, you know, at x minus delta x, divided by something. So I'm just taking sums and differences of Gaussian random variables when differentiating. So derivatives of Gaussian random fields are also Gaussian random fields. And they are correlated with the field which you are differentiating. And this correlation structure you can write down. Okay, so when I have a one variable problem, I now have three variables to talk about. Delta, its first derivative, its second derivative. So I have a 3x3 matrix that I have to discuss. And now I have to place conditions. Condition simply means doing integrals over probability distribution functions with appropriate theta functions and Dirac deltas thrown in. So I will integrate over all values of delta, delta prime, delta double prime, subject to the condition that delta prime is equal to zero, delta double prime is negative. Okay. And in fact, for the one-dimensional case, you can do all of this analytically and write down closed form expressions. The complication here is that you have to do it in three dimensions. So I have a three-dimensional, you know, three spatial derivatives have to be zero, and a 3x3 tensor of second derivatives has to be negative definite. So this is just an algebraic, you know, it's a technical complication. BBKS 1986 told us how to work with this extra complication, and they have expressions that use, and this formalism more or less follows from BBKS. Okay. So let me skip over this idea of the fact that shear in the initial field or tidal shear makes a difference. But the bottom line is that there are all these improvements that you can build into the excursion set picture, which now bring you within about 10% of simulated results. Okay, so that is what is shown here for the halo mass function. Okay, so this is just a comment with something I will not talk about. So this is something that we just saw. You're talking about trajectories in this plane of delta and sigma. There is a nice interpretation that you can attach to the nature of these trajectories. So one thing was that I told you that the barrier, if I change redshift, the value of the barrier will change. So at early times, my barrier is high, and at late times, my barrier is low. Which means, if I look at this trajectory, the barrier was high initially. So this trajectory crossed a high barrier at this mass scale. So this is a small mass scale. So this is a small halo that formed at early times. Then the barrier went low, and eventually maybe it reached here as redshift went closer to zero. When the barrier was here, the same trajectory corresponded to a halo of a larger mass at a lower redshift. Is this picture clear? So what I'm saying is that, let me go back. So this is the barrier. It starts at some high redshift, it's going below. This is my trajectory. As my barrier crosses this trajectory, I can keep interpreting at every redshift, I can keep interpreting the same trajectory in terms of where it is first crossing the barrier for that redshift. So when the barrier was here, the trajectory is first crossing at this mass scale. It's a small mass at high redshift. When the barrier came lower at this mass scale, it's a higher mass at a lower redshift. So this trajectory is describing for you the growth of a single halo. Right? So this halo is increasing its mass in a continuous way along this path. And then there is a jump in mass at the same redshift here. Yeah? So the way one interprets this is that this is smooth accretion and this part of the trajectory is a major merger where suddenly something dramatic happened. So this is one way of interpreting these trajectories in this plane. So just to show you that this is a very rich formalism, you can do a lot. There's a lot of ideas you can put in. Okay, this thing we have seen. Since Ravi made all these nice pictures, I should show you. So he assumes a spherical herd of spherical cows, which are collapsing and forming a bigger spherical cow. And the idea is that given the initial conditions of a Gaussian random process, you can play this game at different places. So I take a big patch, and I say, is it going to form a halo or not? And when is it going to form a halo? Typically, it will form a halo at some late time because it's a big patch. Inside this big patch, I can have smaller patches, which will also satisfy the condition for forming halos at some earlier time. Okay? So I have all these tiny patches, which may form halos at some early time. They are sitting inside a big patch, which will form a halo at some late time. So this excursion set way of thinking also allows you to build a picture of mergers. So I have small objects that form, they merge and become big objects. It goes back to this idea that all of this dynamics happens more or less in place, within order few tens of megaparsec. Right? So whatever I see in the initial conditions, I can actually extrapolate to late times. But I will not say much more about this. So in the last 5 minutes or so, I will introduce the concept of clustering in this language, but I will not talk too much about it. Most of the next lecture will be devoted to a detailed discussion of clustering. But I want to leave you with this idea so that it also becomes useful for the talks that come later today and tomorrow. So we've been talking about this excursion set approach where we have a model. Let's come to that slide later. Where we have a model of the number counts of objects as a function of mass. Right? So we went through all this formalism and it gave us number density of objects of mass m. And what we also saw, if you remember, is that this number density of objects of mass m, it's related to this function f of nu, right? And this f of nu, so this thing, behaves like nu e to the minus nu squared over 2. And nu is a monotonically increasing function of mass. So it is telling you that high mass objects are exponentially rare. The number density of those objects is very small. We also saw this in simulations. This is exactly the behavior seen in simulations. The number density of high mass objects is very small, and time evolution does something. Okay? Good. So keep this in mind. What is interesting here is that these models are saying that the number density of objects of mass m at redshift z is completely described by this quantity nu. And this nu, remember, is this variable delta c. Delta c of z over sigma of m. Right? This delta c, the redshift dependence here, is approximately 1 plus z. If I take lambda CDM instead of Einstein de then that 1.686 also changes a little bit. It also becomes slightly redshift dependent. It's a small effect. Most of the redshift dependence is 1 plus z. The denominator has a mass dependence. And that mass dependence, remind me where it came from? Which equation should I look at? No, there's no stochasticity now. I want a simple equation to tell me how to go from mass m to sigma. What are the ingredients I need? Power spectrum, what else? Filter. Okay, so you give me a filter, you give me a power spectrum, and I can calculate sigma squared as that integral over the power spectrum. It's there somewhere in the slides. Yeah, good. So this is nice because as a function of mass and redshift, there is no arbitrary dependence according to these models. This dependence is what is called universal. And this universality is a theme that will keep coming up. So the number counts are completely determined by this function of mass and redshift. And now you can use this idea even without knowing anything about excursion sets. You could have just used this idea to say something very interesting about the spatial distribution of these objects. This is what Nick Kaiser did in 1984. So this predates all of Peake's theory and the improvements on of Bond et al, etc. It is after Preschecter. So the Preschecter basic picture was in place, but none of the remaining improvements and so on were yet developed. Right, so this tells you that this, whatever we are discussing here, is a very fundamental concept, which is true for a variety of situations. So this goes by the name of the peak background split. So let me just talk about this in 5 minutes and stop. So what we argued is that number counts of halos of mass m, they depend on the mass through some function of delta c over sigma. Okay, we don't need to know what this function is for this argument. There's some function. And basically, this is a thresholding argument, right? So this number counts, whatever you do with excursion sets, all the bells and whistles that you put in, at the end of the day, you're asking how rare is this fluctuation delta C over sigma? Is it a 2 sigma fluctuation or a 3 sigma fluctuation? So basically, these number counts are related to the probability, cumulative probability that your fluctuation is rare enough. Okay? Now, the key idea here is, what is this delta C? So what Kaiser argued is that locally, let us write the fluctuating quantity delta at any given x in terms of two kinds of fluctuations. One is a short wavelength fluctuation, and the other is a smooth long wavelength fluctuation. So in Fourier space, I can always do this. I can pick a scale in Fourier space, and I say everything above this scale is a long wavelength fluctuation, below this scale is a short wavelength fluctuation. So imagine a situation where I have a long wavelength perturbation, and on top of that, I superimpose a short wavelength perturbation, and the sum of this is going to do something like that, right? So I will have a long wavelength field, which is modulating the short wavelength field. So what Kaiser argued is that this thresholding criterion, if I think of applying it locally, then what is going to happen is that all of the fluctuations are coming from the short wavelength part, because that is the thing which is going up and down very rapidly. That is the thing which is going to form halos. It is going to allow velocities to mix, viralization to happen, all that dynamics is driven by the short wavelength field. The long wavelength fluctuation is very smooth. It is probably evolving using linear theory even. Yeah, it's a linear scale. So that's not participating in halo formation. But it is participating in defining the total delta, which has to be above 1.686. It has to be above delta C. So effectively, the fluctuating component only has to reach a local value of the critical density of this barrier threshold, which is not equal to 1.686. It is 1.686 minus whatever this long wavelength fluctuation is doing. Yeah? So all I'm saying is that if I want delta to be equal to delta C, then delta S does not need to be equal to delta C. Delta S can just be delta C minus delta L, and the total delta will still be delta C. Yeah? And delta S is the thing which you need to be fluctuating. This is the fluctuating quantity which needs to cross a threshold. So the local threshold which needs to be crossed is different from the global threshold by this amount. And this long wavelength fluctuation, according to standard cosmology, it has a variance which is quite small, because the power spectrum has less power on long wavelengths, etc. Right? So this delta L is almost certainly going to be a small number. It's not going to be a large number. Even at late times, it's going to be a small number. So now what you can do is say that all of the physics which I used in order to construct this function N of as a function of threshold, that physics doesn't care about whether or not there is a long wavelength perturbation. So if I want to ask what is the number count of objects at a particular location, all I have to do is to take the same physics, and instead of the threshold delta C, I should replace it with the threshold delta C of X. Because the physics is what determined the shape of this function. And all that the long wavelength fluctuation is doing is it's changing the local value of the threshold that you're supposed to reach. Yeah? And then the number counts locally will turn out to be this. So now I can do something. Is this part okay? And if it is not, we can discuss it again later. Think about this a little bit. What one is saying is that the long wavelength field is very smooth. It does not participate in gravitational collapse and virilization, but it does participate in defining the total density contrast at any given location. Therefore, it changes the value of the threshold that you need to reach in order to form a collapsed object. And if this is the case, then now I can just do some algebraic manipulation. Okay, so I will define a number over density field, which is n halo divided by this mean n halo minus 1. And I will just use this expression delta C of X as delta C minus delta L, do a Taylor expansion, and keep leading order term in delta L, because I'm saying delta L is a small quantity. And what I end up with is a delta halo, which is proportional to this delta L, with a proportionality factor which is not equal to 1. It is some quantity which depends on the shape of the halo mass function. Right? And you can in fact work out what that derivative is by remembering that the shape of the halo mass function will look something like this, e to the minus nu squared by 2. So when I differentiate it, this b1, this factor, will turn out to be a number like this, will be a factor like this. This is a monotonically increasing function of mass. Yeah. So this quantity, this factor B, is called halo bias. It will keep appearing throughout the remaining lectures as well. And we can, if you like, we can go over this argument later also. So sorry for going over time again. Let's stop here. Break for tea. If there are questions, I'm around.